gathered as a church, gathered as a people who are longing to trust and to treasure and to follow after Jesus, to be reminded it's okay not to be okay, but we don't stay there, right? Like, it's okay if things aren't great. It's okay if there are tears in your eyes as you sing this morning. It's okay if there's pain in your heart, but we're not going to stay there. The Spirit of God draws us and transforms us and moves. And so we don't have to have everything perfect and together today. So we are grateful for that. Kids will be in with us for the first couple songs. Prior to the sermon, our kids kindergarten and down will head down this hallway for childcare. Our elementary kids have a class every other week, but you're in the service this week. And then just a couple of announcements real quick. If you signed up for membership class, just a reminder that starts today. If you haven't signed up for membership class and you're interested in staying, you can. There's plenty of food. It'll start immediately after the morning service in this room, so just hang out in here and we'll get tables set up. And so if you've signed up, stay. If you're interested in signing up, stay. You're welcome to do that. We'll have child care as well. As the slides have been going through, we have a couple camps this summer. We have one for our elementary age kids that will be those who are currently in second grade. They're our current fifth graders. It'll be July 31st, August 1st, and August 2nd outside of Palo Canyon in Falls. And so you can grab Colby or Heather or Debbie or myself for more information on that as we look forward to that. And then our students are going to Glorieta, New Mexico in June, the 20th through the 24th. And so there's more information available if you want to call her at Jesse. He's been sending stuff out as well. And so just wanted you to be aware of those two things. And then lastly, Karma has an announcement.
We are reviving the Women's Summer Hangouts. So if you were here, 2 years ago before...
3 years ago.
Oh my gosh, before things were bananas up in here. Then you may have been part of this fun summer thing that we did before. Basically, we scheduled some times, like different times of the day, different types of activities for the gals to just get together, hang out, get to meet some of the people who maybe aren't in your GC or who you see across the room, but you're wrangling your children and can't get over there to say hi to them. So we would love you to take advantage of as many of these events as you want to. At the back, on the table where the offering basket is, there's a little card. It looks like this. And it has a list of the whole schedule for the summer. There's also at the bottom where we have set up text reminders through a service. And so if you would like to get texts about the events, they'll come like a reminder a couple days before and a reminder the day of. And that doesn't mean you have to show up for all of them, but then at least you won't be going, oh, I completely forgot about that and I totally intended to go. Not that that ever happens to me. So, like yesterday, anyhow, you just have to text the word summer 22, all one word, to the number on the bottom of the card, which is 806-500-2062. So it's on the card. Also, if you want to take a card and give it to someone that you've been trying to invite to church or someone you've been trying to get to come and get to know this community of people, we'd love for you to, give one to a friend or something like that. Use it for that as well if you like. So those are at the back. If you have questions, you can ask Mary Grace.
All right. Hey, let me pray for us, and we'll begin a time of worship and song. Father, we come this morning, Lord, longing for your presence, knowing that we desperately need you. Lord, for those of us who may come in harder-hearted or struggling or maybe are unaware of our need for you, that we're asking to remind us of that, to stir our affection for you. Father, we trust that you're going to speak through your word as it's preached, as it's sung, as it's read, as it's prayed, and as we engage one another, Lord, that your Spirit would move among us, that you would bring hope and healing, salvation, conviction, Lord, that you would bring peace and welcome, that you would do what only you can do, and that you would be glorified and praised because of it. Father, we pray for the Hermans, the Alexanders this morning as their ministry in Mexico City. Lord, with brothers and sisters that we may not ever know this side of heaven. Lord, we're grateful for the reminder that the church is large and it is far and it is for the nations. So Lord, would we be mindful to pray for them? Father, would you move in their midst for your glory and for our good? Lord, we ask you to do that here as well this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, well, let's hear God call you to worship through his word. Come, bless the Lord, all you servants of the Lord, who stand by night in the house of the Lord. Lift up your hands to the holy place and bless the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion, he who made heaven and earth. That's Psalm 134, 103. And now I'm going to pray a prayer of adoration. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, as your unworthy servants, we give you most humble and heartfelt thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all your people. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all, for your precious love and redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray that you would give us that due sense of all your mercies, that our heart may be sincerely thankful, and that we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory without you. Amen. Please stand and worship.
Down.
things don't go the way I want them to, it takes me about 25 seconds to start wondering why things aren't going the way that I planned them to. And Lord, it's so difficult for us to remember that we're living as a part of your story, that it's so much bigger than us, God, and your plan that has way more to do with our transformation and our sanctification, with us drawing near to you, than it does with us having a perfect little buttoned-up life that we think should be. So Lord, would you remind us in our doubts that you are good, that you are at work, that you are near and present, and that you do not abandon your people. Lord, you didn't abandon your people when they were captive in Egypt. You didn't abandon them when armies came against them and ransacked their cities. You did not abandon them. You were with them in every situation, and you continue to be with your people. We see that as you work through Christians and churches in Syria and in the Ukraine and all across the world, God, as we see our brothers and sisters who are dealing with difficult things. May our hearts be reminded that you are near and present and good no matter what's going on. Please help us today, God, as we look into your word, to come to your table eager and ready to hear from you. Help us to quiet our hearts and our minds, to give you this morning the attention of our minds and the affection of our hearts as we hear from your word. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, speaking of attention, you guys can have a seat, and the littlest kids are dismissed down this hallway, but our bigger kids will be in here with us trying to pay attention. So if they need some help with that, there are some worship notebooks over in the window to help them follow along with the sermon.
No, probably.
Verse 27.
And after this, he went out and saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at the tax booth. And he said to him, "Follow me." And leaving everything, he rose and followed him. And Levi made him a great feast in his house. There was a large company of tax collectors and others reclining at a table with them. And the Pharisees and their scribes grumbled at his disciples, saying, "Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners?" And Jesus answered them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I'm not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." And so we have this like kind of short vignette here of these extraordinary ministries happening, these things are happening, and Jesus is, as he has told us he's going to do, he's just moving throughout the area, and he comes to Levi, who's also known as Matthew. We see this similar story in Mark 2 and in Matthew 9. Comes along a tax collector. And now listen, not that the IRS is like particularly beloved in America, but the tax system in Israel at this time is particularly hated. What would happen was Rome would impose a tax, and then it would just kind of get passed down the line, right, with different levels of bureaucracy. Okay, you're in charge of it. Well, I don't really want to do it, so I'm going to assign it to someone else. Well, what would happen is every time it went down another level, a surcharge would have to be added on top of the original tax to pay for the person to actually collect the money. And so when it finally got down to the one being taxed, they're paying way more than the original tax was because they're paying all these surcharges for tax collectors all the way up, right? And so they're actually being really extorted. And you're working for the government who is in your land. They've conquered you, they're occupying, and so there was a sense of, you're complicit with our enemy. Like, you're a traitor. Like, you're one of us, and yet you're working for them to extort us and to take more from us. Remember back in Luke chapter 3, when John the Baptist's ministry was taking place, and the crowds were coming to him, and people are like, "Oh, okay, what do we do? Like, how do we show God that we're repentant and that we're preparing our hearts for whatever he's about to do?" And one of the ones that asked this were the tax collectors. This is in Luke 3, verse 12. And he says, tax collectors came to be baptized, and they said to him, to John the Baptist, "Teacher, what shall we do?" And his response to them was, "Collect no more than you're authorized to do." He doesn't tell them to leave the profession, but he tells them to be fair in it, right? Like, take only what you're supposed to take, right? Don't extort the people. And so we know that these individuals were disdain. This wasn't just we don't really prefer you. There was like actual hatred, disdain. They were socially kind of ostracized, because people hated who they were and what they stood for and what they reminded them of. When they were reminded by seeing them and paying the taxes, "We're not a free people, Rome's in charge." And so to see Jesus now, after doing these glorious healings, calling a tax collector, right? This isn't a fisherman, this is like an honest day's work, this is a tax collector. He says, "Hey, I want you to follow me." And so listen, if the audience would have initially heard this, you would have stood in one of two camps. Right, you would have either been broken and marred and socially outcast, and so you would have seen this, and there would have been a glimmer of hope of, wait, them? There's hope for me. Maybe this Jesus is for me. And there would have been this the birth of some joy or some hope that this gospel, this good news is for you. Or if you were in the in crowd, if you're in, you're socially, you're acceptable, there would have been a sense of them. Jesus, you misunderstood. Jesus, you don't want them. Right? And there would have been maybe some arrogance, some pride in this. Like, wow, seriously? Not them. Jesus, we hate them. And we are justified in hating them because they're the enemy of Israel, which means they're the enemy of you, God. We don't want anything to do with them. And so you would have either landed and have either one of these camps. And so what we see is that Levi, he leaves the professor behind. He rose and followed him. And then Levi then makes a great feast in his house. And there was a large company of tax collectors, right? That's who he would have known, right? If he's in the a party, he's going to know other tax collectors. And probably have a lot of other friends. And others were reclining at the table with them. And the Pharisees are following Jesus, trying to figure out, who is this guy? Is he teaching Orthodox or not? And so they're around, and this party is happening, this meal is happening. And we see that it says in verse 30 that they grumbled. The Pharisees, the religious leaders, they grumbled at his disciples. Right? They've already kind of put a little bit to shame by Jesus in the last scene, where he knew their hearts, and he checked that by telling someone to get up and walk. And so here they are, and they're grumbling to the disciples. And so you can just imagine the scene, right, where they're standing, or they're sitting over to the side, and they're seeing Jesus interact, and they're wanting him to put them in their place. Like, put these people in their place, Jesus. Recognize us for who we are, and let them know that they're not okay. They're not accepted. And so they're grumbling. And this idea of grumbling is a lack of trust, right? It's a lack of contentment. See, listen, as a quick aside, Scripture gives us freedom to lament. But lament is when we call things what they are and we say that, Jesus, this isn't how it's supposed to be. Like, we're hurting from this, we're broken from this, and we know that this isn't what you intended, but we trust you to be faithful in the midst of it, and so you restore all things. Right, but there's room for us to lament and to share pain and heartache and brokenness with God and say, but I trust you in the midst of it. Grumbling, right, is what Israel did in Exodus as they worked their way through the wilderness, when it was like, hey God, I know you've done some stuff, but you're not doing it quick enough today. Hey God, I know you've provided food every day, but we want meat. Grumbling is saying, God, I don't trust you. You're not doing this fast enough. You're not doing it to my heart's content. You're not doing it to the amount that I want. You're not doing it with the recognition that I want. And so grumbling is not taking our complaint before the Lord and trusting him. Grumbling is saying, God, you owe me, and you're not living up to it. And so here we see the Pharisees grumbling because they're not getting the attention that they want. And it's being given to others. They're kind of saying, hey, this guy seems special. He should notice us. We're pretty special too. And as they're grumbling, right, we have to ask the question, why is this such a big deal? Like, Levi's the host. He's the one that's inviting people. Why is it such a big deal that Jesus is hanging out with Levi and the other tax collectors and not with the Pharisees? Like, why are they so upset about this? And it's because mealtime is like, look, right here, this happening, there is a level of welcoming and acceptance. It feels uncomfortable for the Pharisees, right? That they're not, these folks are not being put in their place, they're not being shamed, they're being like, he seems to be glad to be eating with them, and you're not noticing us. Like, it's uncomfortable for us. Like, why is Jesus doing this? So many of you know, we lived, Carmen and I lived in the Middle East before we had kids for a while. And a common scene would happen that we would be walking down the street and a vehicle would pull up next to us and they would say, hey, hop in the car, come to our house and let us feed you a meal. Now listen, like if that happens to you today, you're not getting in the car, right? Like there's like this sense of this is hanging up on Dateline, right? Like I'm going to run while I pull out my phone. I'm going to scream, like, I'm not getting in the car. And the folks that were, I mean, we've never met these people. But they would pull up and say, hey, come to our house. And in this culture, it's a hospitable culture. As crazy as it sounds, we would often do that. We would go with them. And we would then have a meal. In that meal, we would be sitting, like, reclined around a table in the room. And we would be partaking of a meal where it's a shared meal. And although you have a plate, potentially, you often didn't have a utensil to yourself, and you used your fingers, and you would take the food, and you would eat it, you would dip it, and you would go back, and you would go back. And in that, right, you're thinking, I don't know if I want to do that. Because here's the thing, you're touching their food, and they're touching your food. And so there's a level of, even pre-COVID, right, where there's a level of, hey, but there's an acceptance. If I'm going to do that, if I'm going to let you touch the food that's going in my mouth, if you're going to touch the food that's going in my kid's mouth, I want to know where your hands have been. And so there's a level of like literal social acceptance that's taking place in the Middle East around the meal, because they're saying, we don't agree on everything. We have you here for the meal because we know we don't agree with you on things, and that we can be viewed as the enemy, right? And yet we want to accept you, we want to bring you in, we want to eat a meal, we want to have a conversation. And we learned then, like we didn't leave a lot of meals in complete agreement on almost anything. Religion, politics, like anything. But there was a level of acceptance that was taking place. As Americans, we're used to sitting across the table from someone in a meal. And although we typically eat with people that we like, I can eat with someone I don't know, right? Because you're not touching my food. And I have a fork to defend my food with if you reach for it. Right? And so mealtime is a level of acceptance, but it's not to the depth that we see here in this scene, where Jesus is sitting and he's grabbing and he's eating and he's touching with those that the Pharisees would have said, they're the enemies of our people, Jesus. What are you doing letting them feel like you're okay with them? Think about it. Today, if you go out and you know some dirt on someone, or you know something going on, and you see someone that you respect having lunch with that person, what are the thoughts that run through your head? What? Do they know? They couldn't know, right? Because if they knew, they wouldn't eat with them. Does that mean they agree with everything that person says on Facebook? Right? Does that mean they agree with all the crazy political stuff they say? Is that right? Like we assume sitting and having a meal with someone, what they're saying is, I fully and completely accept, believe, and agree with everything that you do is an affirmation. And we know that's not true. And we know it's not true for us, and we wouldn't want someone to view us that way, but it's hard for our own hearts and minds not to assume that when we see someone that we feel like socially they don't line up, and they shouldn't be having a meal together. And it's hard for us not to believe there's something more going on. We make assumptions. And so, because we live in a divisive culture right now, then we tend to sit with people that we do agree with. Because we don't want to have that conversation all the time. We don't want to argue all the time. And so we then begin to find ourselves in an echo chamber where the only people we sit with are people who agree with us, think like us, and talk like us. And what Jesus is doing here is he's blowing that whole thing up. Right? And he's sitting with folks that are the enemies of their people. And he's having a feast. Right? And the Pharisees are going, you're saying everything's okay, that they're right. I mean, they're just assuming all of these things about what Jesus is thinking or feeling or believing about these people. So Jesus answered them, those who are well have no need for a physician, but those who are sick do. I'm not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. And so the question for us this morning is this, is are we going to look more like Jesus in this scene, or are we going to look more like the Pharisees? Because often the church has had a reputation of being more Pharisaical, right? Of being the ones who have drawn the lines and saying, you can't associate with them. You can't eat with them. You can't talk. Like, we've drawn some of those lines. Historically. But notice what Jesus does here. Jesus initiates the contact. Right? After this, in verse 27, he went out and he saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, follow me. Jesus went after Levi. He didn't wait right for Levi to come to him. He went after Levi. Then Jesus pursues sinners. And what Luke is showing us here is that Jesus isn't just going after those who have physical outcasts, like lepers or someone that's paralyzed. He's also going after those who are socially outcast. He's drawing everyone back in, and he's bringing restoration. He's pursuing sinners. And so, church, we need to be reminded this morning that we've been called in 2 Corinthians 5 to be the ambassadors of God. That we are little Christ who are reflecting his image and his character to the world. Which means that we then are, because we have first been pursued by God, that we become pursuers of people. And not just but the sinners. And the sinners that make you uncomfortable. And the sinners that when people are going to like scratch their head and say, he's eating with them. Like that's what we are to reflect and to pursue and to do. And listen, it's not because we've had it on the back. It's because Jesus has found us in our death, right? In our darkness, in our seat of death. And has brought us out of the pit and has rescued us. And now has called us to be in his master. What did he tell Peter? Hey, you're going to be fishers of men now. Like, you think you're this? You are. But I'm transforming you. And you're going to need to call other people to follow me, to trust me, to know me. And so it means that our homes, our lives, our tables have to be a place of welcome. It has to be a place of security and safety, of honest conversation. So it means that at our tables, there are going to be conversations that make you uncomfortable and spark a little bit, right? Because people are wrestling with real situations and real issues and real doubts and real needs. And they're going to have real beliefs that you don't like. And do we believe that Jesus is sufficient to transform and to rescue? Right? And that often what we see is it doesn't happen in one conversation. It doesn't happen in one moment. It is a process, which means we live in the messy middle. Right? Where it means that there are words are said in the presence of your children, conversations are had, and affirmations are made that you're like, we're going to have to talk about that later. Right? Like, we're going to have to clarify some things here. But that Jesus has called us to pursue those who don't yet know him, who don't yet trust him. And that's what he's doing here. And the religious are over there going, oh, Jesus. And you're wrong on this one. Don't you know who we are? Aren't you going to applaud us? Aren't you going to see us for who we are? Listen, we live, all cultures, not just us, but all cultures have kind of an insider nature to them, right? And listen, whether it's been in school or a sports team or at work or savvy, even in your own family, you know if you're inside or out. You know if you've crossed the line into acceptability and that you are in on all the jokes and all the things, or if you've been removed, and yeah, you can be here. We can't tell you to leave, but you're not on the inside. Like, you've all felt that. And, right, you've probably been on the inside. You've seen that someone was on the outside. But you've probably also been the one on the outside, knowing that you weren't yet a part. Right, that you've hurt. You felt that. Listen, if we go to Isaiah 25, verse 6, this would have been a promise that the Pharisees would have known in Scripture. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine, well-refined. He's describing a feast. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, a veil that is spread over all the nations. He will swallow up death forever. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. The reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken, and it will be said on that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. There was already a hope and a promise that when the Messiah came, that what God was going to do, he's going to throw a party. There was going to be a feast for all peoples, that they would sit and they would enjoy together. And now here we see a fulfilling of this, even just in part. And they're like, not them. Yeah, for us, yes, but not them, right? Jesus, not them, right? Please, not them. And what Jesus is saying, no, I'm bringing the physically outcast, the socially outcast. It is for those who are aware of their need. I'm bringing them in. I'm restoring things. And they're going to enjoy this feast with me. Church, we are not called to consolidate our power and our influence and only have meals and only have conversations with those who can potentially curry favor for us down the road. We are meant to pursue those who don't yet know Jesus, to invite others to come and to eat and to experience what we have tasted and seen that the Lord is good. That we were reminded that apart from the grace of God, we're an outsider. Apart from the grace grace of God, we don't belong. Apart from the grace of God, we're not sons and daughters of the King, and we have no seat at the table. It is Jesus who brings us in, not our own merits, not our own ability, not our own religious background. And so we invite people. Like, what did Levi did? He invited those who were also despised like he was. He's like, come on, like, come meet this guy. Come be a part of what's going on here. Come get in on this. So church, we're called to invite those in our family, those in our neighborhood, those at work, those who are friends or parents or kids, right, involved on sports teams or activities, right? Those in our world. And when we be reminded that they're not a project, here's what I don't want to say here this morning. One, that people are projects, they're not. Or that you flinch or freak out if someone invites you over. Oh no, they think I don't know Jesus. Right? Oh no, they think I'm a social outcast and they want to bring me in. Jesus has meals with those who are far from him and those who are close to him. Right? He is building a family. He's building a family. And so we have meals with those who are already close with us, and we continue to develop those deep relationships, and we are constantly inviting folks to come be a part of it. So as we even look around the room here, there were some who you remember very vividly walking in the door for the first time, wondering if this would be a place you're a part of. And now we can't imagine this place without you. Right? But that happens all the time. It's constantly happening. And so that we are inviting others to be a part of this, that knowing that Jesus has torn down the dividing walls, that we can have everything. Everything can be different in how we view the world. And if we have Jesus, we can begin to build up something together. That Jesus is sufficient. He has torn down the dividing walls. And we can have honest and real conversation and come together. And seeing that folks right now have things that maybe need to lay down in order to trust Jesus. And that we can live in the mess, right? Because grace is present. And that people don't just all of a sudden walk in covered in the world, and the next day, right, look like Jesus. We are transformed from one degree of glory to the next, all rise. Our salvation can be immediate and secure, right, it is, but our transformation is slow. It's a process. It's important for us to know here as well that repentance is talked about. Right, sometimes we'll take a passage like this and say, see, Jesus just wants us to have a good time. He's saying everyone's sin is okay. That's not what this passage is saying. Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, they're aware of their need, like that there's a problem. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. He is calling for transformation and change. He is not there to say, hey, everything y'all are doing, I applaud it. And so would we not use passages like this to say that we are accepting of sin? And it's also not an excuse for us to run out and do our favorite sin and call it mission. Right? Like we're gonna go do the thing that we always wanted to do. We're just gonna call it mission now because Jesus has given us an out. There's a call to repentance here. When he calls Levi, he says, follow me in verse 28. And he left everything. He laid things down. Listen, church. Scripture calls us to lay down the things that are most important to us because Jesus is more important. And it's not you do you. It's to be born again. It is to lay down the old and have the new put on us. And so we're still parents or grandparents, we're still friends, we're still like we're still those people, but our perspective has changed, and our goal has changed, and our priorities have changed, and our commitment has changed. Right? Peter was still actually a fisherman. But what mattered to him now wasn't profit anymore. It was obedience to Jesus. Right? John the Baptist wasn't telling the tax collectors, you can't be tax collectors anymore. He's just saying, do it with integrity. What matters now is different. It's people. It's honoring the one who has seen you and rescued you and called you. And so this morning, the call for us is, what is it that you need to lay down? Like, what is it that you're holding up and saying, Jesus, this is mine, and I'm not laying it down for you? Is it approval? Is it money? Is it power? Is it pride? Is it sin? Like, what is it that you're going, I can't lay this down. Because the scene we have here, right, those who are known sinners, they're laying their stuff down and they're getting Jesus and they're feasting. And the Pharisees are holding on to their stuff. And they're literally at the party in the bar. Not for me. And they're holding on to theirs. And instead of being in a place of delight, they're in a place of disgust. We see the rich young ruler, right? That walks away sad from Jesus because he's unwilling to lay down what it is he has. So he walks away sad. And so do we come to him willing to lay anything down? Because he is more than we need. He is sufficient. He is everything. He is beautiful, and we delight in him. And we know that we're sick, and so that we get help. Or do we hold on to our things and we leave in misery and disgust and grumbling? Because what we've seen in Luke 5 is this, that Jesus, right, remember the leper, he goes, if you're willing, Jesus is willing. Jesus is available. He is approachable, right? And he doesn't leave us the same. The reason he can sit with sinners here is because he's going to pay for it. He's going to the cross on behalf of Levi and the other tax collectors at the table. He's going to the cross on behalf of the Pharisees and their sin, right? Their pride, their independence, their spiritual superiority, their clean sins. He's going to the cross on behalf of our sins so that he can invite us to sit at the table. As sons and daughters, a passage that I love from Isaiah 55. Another promise that they would have had and known. Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. The one who has no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me and eat what is good. Delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear that your soul may live, and I will make with you an everlasting covenant. Right? Like what he's saying is this is it's being fulfilled before their eyes. These people didn't have money to buy, right? They were spiritually destitute. And yet Jesus is saying, no, come and feast with me because I'm taking care of the bill. I'm taking care of it. And you're invited to come and eat and drink like you're the rich, right? Like you're the one that belong, because I'm going to say that you belong. I'm going to live the life you were meant to live. I'm going to die the death that you deserve. And then I'm going to show that I am who I say that I am. And I'm going to come out of that grave, having defeated sin, death, and I've won. And you're welcome at my table. So the question before us this morning is this. Do our lives currently look more like a Pharisee or the tax collector? The one who is gladly, willingly laying things down and sitting at the feet of Jesus? Or the one who is scoffing in disgust? Because Jesus is saying this morning, you can lay it down and trust me, I'm good. You can have seen him take it. And then in that, we walk to reflect that story and that image of Jesus as an ambassador. Not because we're beating our chest or our church, but because Jesus is worth it. And we want others who don't know him yet to come and taste and see that he's good. Let's pray. Father, thank you that this morning your grace far outruns our sin. And whatever thing it is that we are clenching onto, that we are so unwilling to lay down, Father, that you're saying, trust me, I'm better than that, I'm good, I'm what you need, and you're calling us to lay those things down. God, forgive those of us who have tasted and seen that you're good, and now we've picked other things up, and we've become religious. We've forgotten that we were once beggars, and apart from your grace, we would still be beggars spiritually. God, God, would you give us the eyes to see people? To open wide our doors and our arms to say, come and be a part. That we don't meet people with truth, but we trust that your Spirit is pursuing, that your Word is maneuvering, and that you are calling people as sons and daughters to be a part of the family and to sit at the table as those who belong. God, would we not carry ourselves in pride but in humility, gratitude that you have rescued us and redeemed us? Lord, would we gladly be ambassadors, calling others to come and receive what we've received by your grace? God, we want to obey you, we want to trust you, we want to be transformed by you, to see others have that as well. Lord, would you move among us now? In Jesus' name.
Stand or sit with us this morning. Let's respond together to the Lord.
Our deep, the Father's love for us, how vast we are, all measure, that He should give.
Thus says the Lord, let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast in his might. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. But let him who boasts boast in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord, who practices steadfast love, justice, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, declares the Lord. Come on.
I'm standing too long. So, anyway, so we as a church try to live out Luke 5, right? We have been a relationally driven church and wants to live in active pursuit of folks. And for the last, in June, it'll be 11 years, God has been super gracious to us to grow it from, you know, 17 folks on the first Sunday to what it is now by His grace, for His fame, and not for ours. So, you know, I'm one of the elders here, but I'm the only one who is on staff. I'm devoted to this entirely. And so for the last several years, we've just known we needed help. We have several folks who are helping us in part-time roles, but we just knew we needed someone else. Often people say, what do you do during the week? The work, it's literally different, like, every day. And it's like, I don't always know. But the word that I've learned to use is, I'm here to be available, right? So whether that is for counseling, whether that's to help someone move, whether that's for teaching, like whatever it is, I'm available. And we've just needed someone else to be available more frequently because it's just getting beyond that capacity. And so we just started this morning as we've been praying for this for years to let you know that Danny is actually coming on full-time with the church in a pastoral staff role beginning here at the end of the month. Many of you have been in Danny and Lori's home, have been ministered to, prayed for, fed, served by them over the years. And so what a gift that the Lord has answered that prayer by just letting someone who's in the body say, I see the need and I want to do that. And who's just been faithfully doing it anyway, without any recognition, without any pay. Like, so many of you are doing that, and we're so grateful for that. But we just want to let you know that change is coming, and so Danny's going to be available as well. And we'll send out a letter this week with just more details, like just a little bit of what a job looks like. We don't expect you to retain all of that this morning, but we wanted you to hear it from us, that we're just celebrating God's faithfulness, that He has opened that door, and that there's a need to have that. Like, what God has just been kind to us, has been gracious to us for a decade plus now. And so we want to say thank you to Him and let you know what the Lord's doing. So I know you probably have questions, but this is a long announcement, so I'm going to end it there. And holler at us, text us, call us, get Danny's number. Church, hey, we love you guys. If you're here for the membership class, please stay. Otherwise, y'all have a great week. We love y'all.